Sean todos y todas muy bienvenidos al ciclo de conferencias que organiza el ICA y que lleva por título Pensando el mundo y la seguridad alimentaria en América Latina y el Caribe en el post-COVID-19. Para esta iniciativa, el ICA está convocando a un conjunto de referentes de distinguidos países de la región, todos ellos de muy reconocida trayectoria y experiencia y vinculados directamente a las temáticas relevantes de los tiempos que vienen, para discutir cuáles son las principales características de los escenarios que hoy se pueden empezar a vislumbrar. Como dicen algunos, no se trata de volver al viejo mundo, sino de reconstruirlo. Por eso, más que un programa de recuperación, debe ser uno de reconstrucción. Dado que el ICA es un organismo de cooperación técnica, concepto este que implica la construcción de futuro, para nosotros es imperativo comenzar a pensar en acciones para el escenario post-COVID-19. Esto es, además, una demanda que nos llega con mucha claridad desde los gobiernos y desde la sociedad en su conjunto. En nuestra concepción de un ICA puente, un puente que debe acercar países, regiones y actores claves de la agricultura y la ruralidad hemisférica, tenemos una responsabilidad indelegable que no es otra que escuchar, proponer y finalmente actuar. Por eso que en este ciclo en particular nos interesa mucho escuchar a referentes globales y principalmente hemisféricos sobre sus visiones de ese futuro tan incierto que enfrentamos para poder comenzar a anticiparnos a los escenarios proponiendo y actuando. Esa es la razón fundamental, la esencia del ciclo de conferencias que hoy estamos dando inicio. Se trata de una iniciativa de participación abierta, insisto con este concepto, diseñada para promover y facilitar el diálogo. Los temas a tratar se abordarán desde una perspectiva general, referida siempre a los impactos económicos, sociales, culturales, tecnológicos y políticos que hay que anticipar, pero también aspectos específicos que se deberán considerar en las políticas públicas para el sector agroalimentario. Junto con la inauguración de este ciclo de conferencias, también nos enorgullece estar inaugurando nuestra sala virtual de conferencias. Seguramente todos, al ingresar, habrán podido tener esta experiencia que simula estar en nuestra propia casa y así poder recibirlos al menos virtualmente a todas y todos en nuestra sede del ICA. Este ciclo contará con 6 sesiones y 2 charlas, una de ellas extraordinaria y otra de síntesis o de cierre. ¿Cuáles son esas sesiones? Arrancaremos hoy con los desafíos de la postcrisis, que contará con la participación nada más y nada menos que don Enrique Iglesias y Rebeca Greenspan. La segunda sesión abordará del tema del desarrollo sostenible, la agricultura y la alimentación en el nuevo contexto internacional, que será el jueves 14 de mayo con las intervenciones de los doctores Ricardo Abramovay y Guillermo Valles. Los sistemas de innovación y las cadenas de valor en el post-COVID-19 va a ser el martes 19, con las participaciones muy importantes, por cierto, de Elsa Murano y Juan Lucas Restrepo. La cuarta sesión, los efectos sobre el comercio internacional y las regulaciones sanitarias en el post-COVID-19, las debatiremos el próximo jueves 21 con la participación del doctor Cassio Luiselli y Anabel González. El martes 27 analizaremos el tema del abastecimiento, de la agricultura familiar y los circuitos cortos en el post-COVID-19, en donde ya está confirmada la participación de Álvaro Ramos. El post-COVID-19, desde la perspectiva de los países del Caribe, será el jueves 28 con la participación del doctor Chelston Bradway, director general emérito del ICA. La charla extraordinaria estará a cargo de Michael Kremer, Premio Nobel de Economía 2019, sobre los desafíos de la agricultura digital para América Latina y el Caribe en el post-COVID. Estamos aún terminando de ajustar la fecha, pero seguramente va a ser en los próximos días. En la charla de cierre volveremos a encontrarnos para hacer un balance de los principales mensajes recibidos durante el ciclo, a efecto de que podamos identificar luces sobre las características de los escenarios futuros que ya podrían empezarse a anticipar. En todas las sesiones, como facilitador y para darle mayor dinamismo, va a participar un periodista del reconocido prestigio y miembro de nuestro comité asesor en comunicación. En este caso nos acompaña Guido Nehamkis y también estarán en estas sesiones, a lo largo de estas sesiones, Hugo Castellano, Patricia Villasola, Silvio Ulloa, entre otros. Todas las intervenciones aparecerán inmediatamente después en nuestro blog para que a través de este espacio sea posible interactuar con los expositores de cada una de las sesiones. También quisiera comentar que se presentarán en inglés y en español para poder llegar a más personas y de una mejor manera. A fin de mes, vamos a hacer un balance final del ciclo con la síntesis de las principales ideas que nos ha dejado todos estos eventos, para con esto y con nuestras iniciativas en curso podamos continuar sembrando el futuro de la agricultura de las Américas. Muchas gracias.
Bueno, muy buenos días a todos.
Good morning, everyone.
Gracias primero por la invitación.
First of all, I have to thank EICA, the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation on Agriculture, for asking me here. Thank you, Director General Dr. Manuel Otero, for inviting me to this very enriching seminar. We are actually inaugurating a cycle of seminars thinking about the world and food security in Latin America and the Caribbean in the post-COVID-19 world. In these months, since the crisis reached Latin America, we have seen that EICA has been very active, hearing and proposing almost permanently in contact with the different countries. We can see this through the media and all the activities that the Institute has promoted. In this inaugural session of this cycle of seminars, we are having the former secretary of the ADB, Dr. Enrique Iglesias, and the Secretary General of Ibero-America, Rebecca Greenspan, along with the Director General of EICA, to look at this challenging scenario that might be worrisome for us. And it's a good way to face these challenges and the anguish we may feel with experts and people that can bring some light in this trying time. Thank you all for your participation. We will first give the floor to the Director General of EICA with his opening words and the welcome message. And without anything further after that, we will begin the conversation for this important cycle of seminars by EICA. Go ahead, Manuel. Thank you very much, Guido. Good morning, everyone from Costa Rica. Good morning, Rebecca, Enrique. I am very, very happy and honored to have such public figures, such renowned experts worldwide joining us in the inauguration of the cycle. I'd like to emphasize the fact that AICA is a bridge as an institute. It brings together the civil society organizations, the public and private sector, and it has the important role of building for the future. We have to build our future. We have to find a way to go through this crisis and then also think about a post-emergency times in a new society. And I am convinced that you are both ideal to start the conversation about this with your thoughts. At home, they taught me if we had very important people around, you had to be quiet and let them speak. So that's what I will do. I will be quiet. I will be sure to enjoy your words. And then at the end, I would also like to exchange some ideas and words. But thank you very much and a big embrace from Costa Rica. Thank you very much, Manuel. Now, going with our agenda, we will begin with Enrique Iglesias. And then we will go over to Rebecca. So go ahead, Enrique. Thank you very much for joining us. And you are most welcome to this necessary seminar today. Thank you. Let me begin by greeting the Director General, Rebecca, yourself. Thank you for inviting me to the seminar. And first of all, I have to congratulate my friend Manuel and AICA for this initiative. It's been many years, decades, in my relationship with AICA. I've always had great appreciation for their work, for everything they have done. And I've always felt very close to topics on agriculture, cooperation, and inter-American integration, and Latin American integration. So it truly is wonderful to be here with you, although we are distant. We feel close through this initiative. It's of great interest to think about what's happening in the world today. And within that situation, what role food security will play. I'm not a specialist on food security, but I will mainly focus on the first part of this conversation, of the title. And of course, a reference to something that refers to its goal. Food security. The times we are living are truly dangerous and exceptional. We would have to go back 100 years to find any similar situations. So the first conclusion you might draw from this are the elevated costs in terms of people that have been affected, people that have passed away, but also one contribution that has already been highlighted by the president of the Elcano Institute a few days ago, saying that this led us to find that there is a world out there when 180 countries or 200 are connected through a virus that brings death and disease, in just 2 or 3 months, we understand that there truly is a human species and that there are dangers that are similar to species that have had these dangers throughout history. So there is a world. We are part of the world as a species. That's an important acknowledgement, a bit of reality to understand what it means to be aware. We are something that belongs to the environment. We belong to the climate and all the consequences there can be in these global matters. Climate is definitely one of them. As we all know, this crisis is dramatically affecting all humanity. I will refer to 3 points. and the lessons we can draw from the first stage, which is this initial fight against the virus, the quarantine. The second part is how we exit that gradually, and what this implies, and this would probably bring us to the second half of the year throughout, and then next year, where we hope to have the news that there will be response from scientists, a vaccine, for example. That will also be a period of challenges for humanity, a new way of conceiving multilateralism. So with those three dimensions, I will first refer to the first part, what we're living through now, confinement, being quarantined and inside our homes, hearing the call of the authorities and the state to decontaminate or decontage or stop the contagion of society. In my personal experience, at least, it's been a very singular thing. And it has the immediate consequence of bringing the state to the center of great decisions and great responsibilities. It is a kind of empowerment of the state. And I think that after the discussions we've heard in the past decades over state or non-state, here we clearly see that the responsibility is taken on by the state. The state is making decisions first, looking at science. States have decided that isolation is the only instrument we have to face this phenomenon. And also states looking at the direct social and economic impacts that this measure has. Therefore, the idea of confinement has brought along reactions that we can highlight. I'm quite surprised. I had to go through this in Madrid, and I'm seeing how society is reacting. Of course, there's exceptions, but overall, I have the impression that in the response to this matter, there's great social responsibility. And this is very important. We can see people accepting that responsibility, and along with that, the contribution of the scientific community, and how those two elements, or three, state, scientific community, and the contribution of society, we are finding a way out of this problem, at least in the most immediate sense. So that's the first lesson we can draw. The world learned how to react with very strong measures. Society accepted them with responsibility, of course, with the exceptions we have in any community, in any human community, but also with a responsibility and a commitment from healthcare sectors. That started with the difficulties in facing the problem in some cases, but what I'm seeing here in Spain, at least, you can see the capacity to react and to bring this policy forward that is giving results, at least in most countries. Of course, we are not exempt from this repeating itself or from having a spike, a new spike in the virus, but at least we can see the first lesson learned of efficiency. This confinement had an immediate impact on the economy and on society as well. On the economy, because it removed businesses from the system. That, of course, has its immediate impact in terms of production. This year, there are estimates that production will fall 10 to 15% in most countries. This is something we had never seen before. And socially, also, because we see differences in terms of the capacity of keeping up your quality of life, your livelihoods, and how to face problems such as poverty, feeding yourself, and caring for different sectors and most vulnerable sectors of society. So that was the first package of conclusions. The second part comes with deconfinement, how to come to this new stage in society where we are no longer isolated, we are no longer locked in our homes, and now we have the big responsibility of revitalizing markets. Here again, it is also very complicated, and there are important consequences and challenges there. Once again, the main actor is the state. In this case, the state will have to include the possibility of having agreements with society, with the private sector, with the work sector. A tripod on which you can mount your response. And this is extremely complex. This is because different from the crisis of 2008, that was just a crisis in supply, this crisis is a crisis of supply and demand in an international context that does not have many stimuli. We have the first part, which is supply, the closure of all the small, medium, and even large enterprises. Along with that, we have very specific problems of sectors that have been severely affected. And these are very important to understand the magnitude of the unemployment that can come. We have the whole tourism sector, culture, sports. And in Latin American society, it's large informal sector. People that are not there on the streets only because they live on the street, but because they work on the street, and they depend on that for their livelihood. So this altogether means that the demands of society and the social side will depend on the possibility of opening up business spaces in all these dimensions. So this large challenge of supply is present, and also of demand. In supply, we saw all types of businesses close. We also have the international situation that is also affecting commodities. Look at oil prices. And also a community that is very influenced by the negative perspectives of developed countries, which perspectives also can be seen in the exit of capital and capital leaving Latin America. So this just gives us a very complicated situation, a lack of resources to face this. And right now, what concerns us most, I would say, is finding a way to once again reach large agreements with the main stakeholders of these times. The three sectors need to have the capacity to interact, and we need to bring to the table all the opportunities that are coming along with this, of supporting micro enterprises and SMEs, agricultural businesses, especially small farmers, to help us manage the economic side. I think that there will certainly be opportunities to do things in our region. And I can give you my perspective on this as well. But I think that the social support by the state will be fundamental. And to that, I have to add something I feel that is very positive. In all my years working in Latin America, I had never seen such a massive reaction of international funding mechanisms like the IMF, the Inter-American Bank, the World Bank. So there's really been a massive reaction to try and face this. And we see very flexible characteristics that were unseen, at least in the experience I had in the previous world. And this is good news. Considering the combination of supply and demand and the economic crisis we have, it's so important to have international support. So in this second stage, the big challenge, I would say, is how Can we avoid companies closing? How can we avoid traditional sources dying? How to maintain these? And how to have the business sector respond? Understanding that the state is doing so much to keep companies alive, this brings responsibilities to companies as well. An article I read yesterday said that businesses have to respond to this massive support by the state and the international community. And the third dimension I wanted to bring up is that next year is the year of our greatest hope. Hopefully we will see something happen to deal with this health issue. And so next year, we will have a very important crisis of all the edifice of international cooperation that started, or similar to what happened after the Second World War. At that time, the creation of multilateral structures to support through the United Nations, through financial support, looking at the commercial side with the WTO, there was a whole tendency in the world to have an international sphere very regulated. That also went through with the creation of the European community. So multilateralism responded to the complexity of the problems, thinking about how difficult the problems would be. It was not just a matter of peace and after war, but they did so many things. Certainly so many things have happened thanks to this. If you look at the times between 1915 and 1945, it's a period of extraordinary transformation. Population tripled, but also production grew 12-fold. And there was less poverty. So all this happened thanks to this fundamental structure of having multilateral rules that all countries can agree on to bring the world forward and to help the economy. And that is actually in danger today. It's in danger, and it would be very, very serious to have the third stage of this crisis finding us with a community that cannot react to these challenges, with tensions among the big powers, economically, politically, where this edifice that was built on so much sacrifice and with such success that managed to have rules agreed on for the whole world, it's in danger. And so that is my biggest concern of what we're living through now. So looking at that, we have to think about that third stage, when we can finally cope with the health emergency and using scientific achievements to get out of that crisis. We need to find the ways in which the large problems of trade and others can be helped through international cooperation. We cannot accept that one or two countries be the ones to decide over the rest of humanity. That cannot happen. So I think that it is very important to do anything we can to bring that together again. And there we find some of the answers that can be coming out of this seminar. In this search, there's no doubt that agriculture and Latin American cooperation and integration have a very important role to play. We know that Latin America is one of the largest providers of food to the world, and technology can help a lot in this sense. So in that context, to help develop Latin America and to serve the great demands of worldwide food security, we definitely need a multilateral framework that gives us general rules with which we can move to know where to go. And regionally, coming back to something that many of us have said before, having much more efficient inter-American cooperation. This is a dream that we will have to fight for. And just to find a small example, let's look at Costa Rica, where AICA is at. It's a great country, still a model in many respects. It belongs to a region that already in the 1950s and 60s started trying out how to integrate. And it is actually the most successful experience we have in Latin America, what they've done in Central America. They've done it modestly, but they've done it and they've maintained it. So in that sense, I have to say to all our friends at AICA, you have to find a way to keep our agriculture alive. It's one of the great reserves for worldwide food security. And keep insisting on regional cooperation. You've done it very well over time. We definitely need regional cooperation to be better stakeholders among ourselves and for the world. So those are the three dimensions. Are probably common sense, but I think it's just three moments in time that the situation is calling for us to understand that Latin America is essential for food security. This is based on our own capacity of helping ourselves to improve it, and also on integration, and we can be actors in the multilateralism we would like to have for the future. Thank you. Thank you, Enrique. Very interesting words. Your insights and perspective give us food for many questions and thoughts. It is a bit unsettling, but it also gives us hope. So with that, we now have Rebecca. And after that, we will go to some questions. There are so many we would like to ask already. So, Rebecca, thank you. Welcome again. Thank you for joining us in this seminar. And you have the floor. Thank you very much, Guido. Just as Enrique, I have to start by greeting everyone, especially AICA, the Director General Manuel Otero. AICA was my home at some point of my professional career. I remember it very fondly. In Costa Rica, Coronado, a really beautiful place. Congratulations also, Manuel, for everything that AICA is doing. I've been closely following some of the things you have made available throughout the crisis, the online courses you're giving, the biosecurity apps, really interesting, the blogs and the seminars, helping us keep abreast of the times with dialogue in the agricultural and rural sectors, and the monitor that has very interesting facts on what is happening in the region, in the countries, and the world. So once again, AICA, thank you very much. And thank you for this very special invitation. It's so special to me having AICA in Costa Rica and having worked there. So thank you and congratulations for all your work at AICA. And Mr. Enrique, warm embrace to you. I admire you so much and I'm very fond of you. I always tell Mr. Enrique that he is the president of Latin America. And I always say this, I did not come here to the secretariat to substitute him, but just to follow him. It's always an honor to be here with you, Mr. Enrique. I think he has already given us a great overview. And so let me try and organize it differently, maybe starting with a provocation. I was telling Mr. Enrique Iglesias in one of our virtual conversations here in Madrid that I think this is the real beginning of the 21st century. Centuries don't always begin chronologically. This is definitely a turning point. It is something that will mark the difference of what was happening in the past 70 years in the world and what will happen going forward. In that sense, what we do now will also determine our future. And this is in part the discussion that is being fostered by EICA. In this 21st century, I have no doubt, and Enrique has already mentioned this, that this will accelerate many of the processes we were seeing already. Undoubtedly, technological processes, everything that is related to the digital society, and probably what we already saw in terms of a new geopolitical order in the world. And part of this new order will be seen and is already being seen in the multilateral world. I truly hope that after this crisis, we can draw the right conclusions on our interdependency that has already been so evident through coronavirus. I would like to have more multilateralism, more cooperation, more coordination, and more solidarity, of course. And hopefully we can avoid greater protectionism, isolationism, and discord. Because that would not lead to a better world, not after this crisis. Now, that possibility is just that, a possibility. What conclusions can we draw from this crisis, from this pandemic? I think this is still an open question. We will see strengths and forces bringing us to different sides. And that's why it's so important to do this, what we're doing now, a call for integration, to regional action, to giving a voice to our countries in the Concert of Nations. Because there will certainly be debate on the multilateral architecture and how that will look in the world post-COVID-19. And Latin America will be able to have a relevant voice in that discussion. Secondly, I would say that this pandemic interacts with our structural problems, with our capacities, and even with our disadvantages. COVID-19 interacts in our region, in Latin America, with the structural inequalities and the weaknesses we have in our productive system and our social and political system. And of course, we are concerned there. As we heard Enrique say, this pandemic produces effects in the healthcare sector, in the economy, in the social and political sectors. And I had never seen this type of profound effect in my lifetime. It's a very different crisis we're living. Therefore, the instruments we have to make available to fight it have to be different as well. In the health side, we have never seen something with such a large and profound effect worldwide. And in the economic and social aspects, the same. The impact we will see in the developed world and the developing world is profound and concerning. Depending on what we do now, we will see how that impact will affect the structure, whether it will just be a short-term effect or if we will be living through the effects in the medium and long term. And the impact of this pandemic are differentiated impacts. We all have the same probability or likelihood of getting the disease, but we don't all have the same likelihood of recovering. If we look at the most vulnerable sectors, they are very much affected, and they can suffer more severely, even brutally, I would say. So we can see the differences and inequalities affecting us in the region. And we can look at the numbers, the projections. Again, these are concerning, to say the least. 30 million more people falling under the line of poverty this year. 16 million of those in extreme poverty. And there, we can definitely link it to a food crisis. We're talking about hunger in important sectors of our population in Latin America. We've also seen differences in access to digital society. Children that can study through the internet and those that cannot. Those that have access to teachers that can use technology and those that do not. We've also seen differential aspects in terms of gender. Gender violence in confinement is not a minor issue. And the problem of occupations that are generally held by women and are most affected by this. Will we also see a regression in the role of women in society if we are confined and limited to domestic work? Will this disruption require more domestic work than what we had seen in the previous evolution of work? Or if we think about AICA, what will be the impact of this in the rural sector, not just agriculturally speaking, but the whole rural sector of our economies? What will the rural sector look like? Will it be more vulnerable and marginalized? Not necessarily because of the pandemic itself, because being far from the centers of disease and the cities, they might not be directly impacted by disease. But look at the effects that we might have in Costa Rica. We heard from Enrique the problem with tourism. Much of the dynamics in the social sector in Costa Rica depend directly on tourism and ecotourism. There will be a disruption in this, and this, of course, might entail problems that we will not see recover as quickly, such as transport, airlines, tourism. And there we also have disruption in the food chain, a concern right now, and this is more a question to AICA. It might not be so much that there will not be enough production, but the distribution chains might suffer disruptions. And that, of course, plus the differences in terms of distribution, could certainly lead to food security issues in our countries. Enrique also mentioned this, and it's the fact that this crisis has made us face one good thing, which is valuing again the public sector. This is more broadly understood, the public sector in terms of the collective sector, not just the government, but what each of us can do publicly to build public assets, public good, where also the private sector has an important role to play. If there is a time where the private sector had to show its more social face, it's this. Therefore, that construction of the public sphere depends not just on what the government says today. That's, of course, essential, but it depends also on the individual behavior, on the behavior of companies and businesses. Normalcy depends on the capacity of people going back to work, not just the social policies or economic policies of the government. So that individual responsibility of our own behavior and the responsibility in the private sector and the public sector are also evidence of the death of the false dichotomies of the past, if you will, where you had the dichotomy between the public and private sector, civil society and other sectors of society. I think now those dichotomies are weakened because the only possibility for a future is to cooperate and to have the cooperation among the different sectors in society and of citizens themselves as well. Once again, here we have a revaluation of citizens themselves, of bringing new value to each of us, to each of our behaviors and our conduct. And this was already a trend, but of course it is accelerated through this crisis. And to close, if we look at the political side, there's diverse reactions in the crisis. On the one hand, we've seen presidential figures strengthened in Latin American countries, at least in those that have shown leadership in the crisis. And that is good. That is good because most of the countries in the region have acted responsibly, have shown a commitment to the tasks at hand. We heard it from Enrique as well. Countries took the steps that were necessary. They saw what happened in Europe. Most took very early steps, very responsibly, learning through what had happened in the rest of the world. But this moment can be very different from what comes next, because this moment is one that calls us together so that we can come out of the worst part of the pandemic. But the next moment is when we will really see what we have lost. It will give visibility to the real social and economic impact. Unemployment, if we just look at numbers from the ILO and ECLAC, we have very difficult numbers there. The loss of formal employment only, when we also know that almost 50% of our population is informally employed, and of course will also be greatly affected. And on top of that, we will see formal jobs affected. Unemployment, if I remember correctly, will increase, at least in first projections, by 12 million people in Latin America. So it's already two digits of unemployment, plus the equivalent unemployment that we have in the informal sector. So to close, I'd like to give these messages. First, it's something I've repeated over and over. It's that the short and medium term start at the same time. And this is the best time to look at it that way. Whatever we do today will determine the impacts we will see tomorrow and how severe they will be. Will we only protect the poor? If we do so, we won't protect the informal sector, those that are not poor but will suffer so much in the pandemic and have no social protection in our society. If we do not understand that the mid-sectors will also be impoverished and that we need to talk to them as well, it will be much more difficult to recover. And our political system will be much more unstable. If we don't find a way to preserve the productive fabric within this crisis, in our region, this means micro and small and medium enterprises and the rural sector, the productive units in the rural sector, recovery will be much slower because we just won't have the social fabric to be able to quickly recover. And if we do not have good leaders in every sense of the word, and politically and privately, much of what happens in this crisis will depend on the quality of our leaders. And there, we have to call on the leaders of the private sector, leaders of civil society, public leaders, a call to dialogue, to get to the specifics, so they may execute and design policies. This will also determine how our societies will come out of this, whether we will be more fragmented or more cohesive after this crisis, to then face the large challenges coming. And then, of course, regional leadership. I also believe in integration. I believe in integration now more than ever. The response is more important to call for cooperation, not just individually. We have to find a way to draw the right conclusions from this pandemic, from this crisis. What we need to build different societies, but also better societies. We need for that more solidarity, more coordination, more cooperation, more multilateralism, more integration, and better leaders. Thank you. Thank you very much, Rebecca. We are very grateful for your participation that also trigger so many questions. But before that, I'd like to give the floor to Dr. Otero, so that we open the floor for some questions now. I'm sure he has some. So with that, we can see if there are questions by Dr. Otero. If not, I have some myself. Go ahead, Manuel. Yes, thank you so much. I truly feel honored. It's wonderful to have these great participations by our presenters. As Director General of AICA, of course, I have a first question that refers to multilateralism, because the crisis of multilateralism also drags technical cooperation behind it. AICA is a small regional agency. Sometimes we are not hit directly by the wave, but evidently, we are in a situation that is quite paradoxical. We have more and more demands for technical cooperation to our organization, but we know there's a structural crisis of cooperation. I can assure you that in a week or less, you can prepare a meeting of ministers and you see the solidarity. A vocation to find very important supranational matters, matters that go beyond our borders, but this has a very weak architecture. AICA started in 1942 in the midst of the Second World War. I say that we know how to face a crisis and live through it. As Enrique said, we have to go back to that spirit of 1942. Or 1945 for the EU. We need more technical cooperation, but it has to be a different technical cooperation. Could you help me think about this new multilateralism that comes? Knowing, of course, it's difficult to specify it, but any more ideas on how this will be in future? Something else I'd like to hear is, we know that ministers are willing to promote trade, to have less regulation, and to find a way towards integration. The question is, as we've seen in other crises, I'm sure you remember them, there's been many where if there's a price increase, there's these wonderful programs to find more supply of grains, etc. But once it's over, everybody forgets about it. And again, you see the same problems come up and the old dichotomies, as Rebecca said, rural versus urban, industry or agriculture. I'd like to think that we're learning and that we are mature enough now as society so that once and for all we can turn the page. So the two questions are closely related to this idea of new multilateralisms and whether it will truly be the end of false dichotomies that have damaged us in the past. Thank you. Very well, let's have Enrique first with his views. And if I may, I would like to add to Manuel's questions, because Enrique also mentioned that we are in a very exceptional and even dangerous time, and that there are threats to the great edifices of international cooperation in the past years. So just to add that nuance there to the questions. Yes, thank you, Manuel. Thank you, Rebecca, also for your words, and Guido for your question. What Manuel said is very relevant. You said that EICA is a small institution, but it has achieved a level of cooperation that I have seen with the ministers of agriculture that's quite impressive, and it has always been impressive. I'm sure it will be more so now. And there, I just want to share some thoughts that I always tell my compatriots in Uruguay. Being small sometimes is quite a good deal. I'm telling you, and of course, Uruguayans of the North, which are Costa Ricans. In the world we live in today, being small can certainly have its assets. But of course, we need to know how to handle ourselves. What you mentioned in terms of collaboration is closely linked to the idea of multilateralism. And yes, it has suffered a lot, and it has continued to suffer because some large countries just don't believe in it. They don't see the usefulness, or they don't think it's worth the expense. I think we might still continue having that. But if you look at the reaction by multilateral cooperation just to legitimize itself, the millions of dollars it has promised through the international financial system, it's truly impressive. The same from the European Bank and the support it has provided to the European Union. If at all, it should help us at least ask ourselves what we would have done without that help. So that brings it to the point. The virus itself, the pandemic, is also showing the importance of international cooperation. The first ones that see this are scientists. There's been great cooperation among different institutions. I've never seen something happen that way before. So much world cooperation in health. It's a great institution. And they've also started mentioning this kind of thing. It could happen, a new virus. And you always thought, oh, that's Jules Verne, and that's never going to happen. But it did. It did, and The WHO certainly was aware of the possibility. So I think in this crisis, we see the clear importance that multilateral aid has in the financial side, in the scientific side, most clearly. But yes, there is a lack of belief in multilateralism. And it goes along with general lack of hope in regulations or disbelief in regulations. Many countries think they can do things individually. We have to overcome this. I think that now the way out of this pandemic and how we come out of it might help us open our eyes that we are all together in a planet and we have to face these problems together. For example, just climate change. This very painful issue of the pandemic has raised awareness in global climate change as well. So there are many things happening. Of course, there's unfortunate costs that come along with it, but there's one good thing, and it's bringing us all awareness of ours being together on this planet. And then, of course, multilateralism has to adapt itself to the new situations. As I said, we had important milestones happening in 1945, in 1991, with the WTO. But they will now have to look at the new issues, the new problems, and finding a new way of solving problems, but always keeping that structure of bringing all countries to participate. And an example we should follow is understanding that the spirit that you have for collaboration at AICA and an institution like yourselves can certainly be extended to other spheres. Thank you, Enrique. And now we have Rebecca. And of course, with the same questions of Manuel, if you allow me, I would also like to ask something else or add something. And based on what Rebecca already brought to the table, the role of Latin America and the possibilities Latin America has of becoming a relevant voice. In a continent that has great natural resources and the condition of being a great fruit producer, and how we can find a new valuation of rural worlds, not just the agricultural sector. So, Rebecca, go ahead. Well, there's several things there. First, I absolutely agree with Manuel and Enrique in the sense that we need to improve multilateralism. We do not have to weaken it. There's no doubt that it now has to adapt to the new conditions of the 21st century. And this is still something that is pending. But to perform this task, we need to find ways to enhance and strengthen multilateralism. I personally would like to say that I would have liked to have seen more coordinated efforts in the international world in the pandemic. I think that the WHO did what it could, but the WHO has a limited mandate and limited instruments regarding the pandemic. So the first lesson we can learn is looking at what the system we already have in the world and what it needs to be able to respond to coming pandemics, because this will not be the only one we will see in the century. For me, there was a much better and much more coordinated response with Ebola. There was response from the Security Council. This time, the Security Council has not pronounced itself. It has not been able to negotiate a resolution. And it's just more fragmented. I have seen the international system act more in coordination in the past. And I think that this global problem led to fragmented action. Borders were closed, trade was closed, there was a worldwide fight for the elementary equipment, for tests, reactors, protective equipment, and there was disruption of trade and borders in a very uncoordinated manner as well. So I really would have liked to have seen a more coordinated approach. That is definitely something we need to learn for the future. We have to improve on how we deal with this. I also think that it is true that the financial world and the regional financial banks have reacted. But I'm concerned about the middle-income countries in the Concert of Nations. At the G20, I think the G20 is being called now by Saudi Arabia, presided by Saudi Arabia, and G7 by the United States. And I think that the response in 2008 in G7 and G20 was more coordinated again than what we are seeing today. It is true that we have seen solvency in the world. The European Bank has done taken very important steps. Even in the developing world, central banks are playing a role that they did not have a while ago and trying to provide solvency to countries needing it at these times. But again, if you compare the economic packages of the developed world and the developing world, you see that there are great asymmetries still. In the developed world, economic packages are over 20% of the GDP. In the developing world, it's less than half. In Latin America, we might say that the large packages will be around 6 or 10% of the GDP, looking at the tax side and the monetary side. So we need an international world to close that gap. The G20 has already pronounced itself over the poorest countries in the world, but there seems to be no appetite to say anything about middle-income countries. And 70% of poor people live in middle-income countries. And middle-income countries are greatly vulnerable to the crisis, given the disruption of international trade, precisely. Half of the help will come from outside, half of the impact will come from outside, and half will come from these health measures. So with that, we need to make a call and bring our voices together. Guido was asking about the voice of Latin America. I think we need a coalition of middle-income countries to bring visibility to what they are living through, what they're going through, and the response that they need from the international world. And something else I think is very important. We need more cooperation, but a different type of cooperation is what Manuel said, and I absolutely agree with that. First of all, I think we need a more horizontal cooperation, not so much a vertical cooperation that some know what to do and they just help the others downstream to do what they need to do. We need cooperation where we learn horizontally from each other, where we understand the diversity in which this cooperation happens, and where mutual respect and mutual learning is fundamental. And that is related to the type of integration we need. We need a different type of integration. I agree that big words and large structures for integration is not what we need in this century. The cooperation we need has to come from the bottom up. We need to facilitate things to have cooperation and integration among companies. We have to remove obstacles for people moving around. Of course, in the pandemic, we would have to consider the new reality, but I think we need to allow integration of people, integration of companies, not just governments as it was before, not just top level. Governments can facilitate or hinder integration. We want them to facilitate, but they're not the only stakeholders in integration. Integration is more than what we perceived before, where we started with the large customs union, customs associations and borders. Now we also have linguistic integration, cultural integration, educational integration, an integration that the new technologies allow much more than before. We need to bring this to the international world. And the voice of Latin America is the voice of values, along with the voice of Europe. We still defend the values of democracy, trade, openness, cooperation, multilateralism. That is the voice we need to bring up. Along with Europe, we need to speak about this. Thank you, Rebecca, if you allow me, based on some common points of your presentations, Enrique and Rebecca. You both bring similar points. You've mentioned social responsibility, reappraisal or revaluation of the public side, quality of leaders. You mentioned the importance and the role of the state and of citizens. Using a bit of my role and liberty as a journalist, I'd like to ask you, how can we work on minimal agreements, at least, in the context of divisive and polarizing leadership? Where to begin would be the question. Enrique? Well, how we can stimulate agreements among countries or within countries, this, of course, depends a lot on leadership and the leader promoting the agreement. There should be a leader or a party leader, someone that promotes dialogue and cooperation. Something interesting we see with this pandemic is that in some countries, there are gestures of trust by leaders. They believe in what is being done and how it's being done. This type of credibility is very important to find leadership within parties and among them. Now, there's no theory for this specifically. Some people have the capacity of communicating and of earning the trust of public opinion, and based on that, negotiating and building bridges to communicate with others, and thus having an impact on public opinion. Sometimes the severity or seriousness of things brings us necessarily to agreements. By definition, this virus, this pandemic, should bring everyone together. It has not been the case everywhere. We see this in Latin America, we see this in Europe. So, with a big conflict, a large problem, it tends to be easier to bring people together. Whether or not this happens, it also depends on the situation in each country. I do see that facing this situation with determination and just that trust. So one of the things I admire in politicians, I'm not a politician myself, but just earning that trust, having people believe them. And a conflict as the one we have now opens spaces for these types of leaders. So again, there's no theory. There's times in history where we've seen great leaders just out of historical coincidence. Today, we see leaders being confronted or opposing others worldwide. And in these times, we also need to find a way to earn trust and communicate with people so that we can do something with that trust. So again, I don't know of any theories explaining why a leader emerges. They do. But the basis is having ideas that allow us to have a dialogue and communicate with people, to lead wills in the right direction. It's a very difficult question, Guido, but Enrique has given us the key. I agree with him. One important thing is to recover trust. If you look at the Latin barometer for Latin America, you are just surprised in how citizens did not trust public institutions. This pandemic might have helped people reappraise and give new value to public institutions and how they defend the population. Hopefully, this will be kept up post-crisis, not just at this time in the health emergency, but later, because that will lead to better public policy, a better public dialogue and a social dialogue. I still don't know, really. The polarization we saw in the region before the pandemic, I don't know if it has just taken a breather through the pandemic and it will come back. I just don't know. I cannot answer that. And the same goes for regional polarization. How can we get to minimal agreements? Well, I think that we have to go to very specific issues. We understand, of course, that it would be wonderful to have more collaboration of technological and scientific systems of our countries to face the future. We should do so much more there. In the Ibero-American sphere, we are trying to do that. I think we need to do more in the creative industry and the cultural sectors of our countries. Having two languages that are closely related is a big advantage in the world. So I would really look at specifics. Right now, I would not try to think too big in something that takes us out of people's everyday realities. I think we can agree if we look at our everyday needs and the specifics that the region calls for. We will achieve much more if we focus on that. Thank you, Rebecca. With that, I think it'd be interesting to hear from Manuel. EICA, I think, and overall agriculture, trade in agricultural products, and the design of common protocols can help us keep the exchange alive. And they have been a great example of convergence and agreements. So, Manuel, after hearing Rebecca and Enrique, agriculture can certainly be a sector that can give us an example to find more ambitious or larger agreements later. Or not necessarily ambitious, because, of course, agriculture is such an important sector, but it can help us gradually go over to other activities. Thank you, Guido. Yes, I have an anecdote, actually. In the last 60 days, EICA has organized six or seven sub-regional ministerial meetings. Two of those were done under the Southern Agricultural Council, Mercosur plus Chile and Bolivia. In both, we had participation. And what's interesting is that ministers of Brazil and Argentina, excellent ministers, Teresa Cristina and Luis Basterra, announced that they are leaving their weapons behind and they're starting a process to dismantle the technical barriers to trade that prevailed for decades and probably with no reason. So the crisis, I don't know if it's the most proper idea, but to put down the weapons and to work together. Other countries in that bloc, seeing them, have said, we want to be part of this. So EICA is trying to be the maker of this current of sympathies that help us eliminate barriers to trade or tariff barriers. I think this is a great opportunity for a continent that for so long had the sad record of having an intra-bloc trade that was even worse than Africa. So the time has come to be practical, to find that solidarity and practicality to help each other. I think 2 days ago, Roberto Rodriguez, the great Minister of Agriculture of Brazil in the first Lula government, he said that we are learning to live with less clothes, with less luxuries, less cars, and we will have to continue living with our three meals a day. And here I have to express pain and solidarity to those that are going through food security problems. But Latin America has to learn to have state policies for agriculture, for globality. Some people are unemployed in the cities, working in the informal sector, and they're coming back to the rural areas. They're going back to the rural areas. They don't have any training. So hopefully, we can find a new way of imagining our agricultural sector, finding bioeconomies and helping us that become the new way, not just producing commodities. So we're working on that. I also liked what Rebecca said. The basis of new cooperation are from the bottom up, and the ministers of agriculture are showing this. And the public-private cooperation should be horizontal. And also, the same goes for regional asset, public good and public assets regionally will be more important. We're trying to create a regional system for innovation as well. We cannot see every country in Central America have their own innovation institute. We have to all come together. And this is especially true for the Caribbean, one of the regions that will be most hit by coronavirus, and where we have hurricane season coming, and they say this season will be stronger than the previous one. We definitely need to create the conditions there for rapid local production of food. So the matter of public policy and state policy for agriculture that started in learning in the United States and in the EU with their rural development legislation, we have to work on that as well. Thank you. Thank you, Manuel. And so, Enrique, Rebecca, I'd like to ask you for closing remarks, and then we will have the Director General with a conclusion. We have discussed very important matters, and this has been a great conversation where we can certainly learn many things. Especially, I highlight the hope for all of us that although we have difficulties and differences, and there's been questionings, in the case of Latin America and the Caribbean, the possibility of the agricultural sector and rural territories becoming a right area to find minimal consensus to begin. Well, I think these comments on cooperation really come at the right time. We have to think about what this all means for the development of humanity. One of the great reserves we have is the growing international market and having food in regions such as Asia and Africa. This will be a permanent challenge. And there we have a great opportunity, not just with consumption of our popular sectors, receiving what our countries produce, but also being able to be part of worldwide consumption and enter that dynamics. Food security covers all countries. It covers the world. So we have to be very glad of many things that we've done in Latin America. We can certainly be proud of what AICA has done, FAO, and other worldwide organizations. There's been an awakening of sorts, just as there has been an awakening of cooperation, as Manuel remembers the cooperation with Argentina and Brazil, the great industrial revolution and agriculture in Brazil and Argentina, and the great intercommunication we see. My country has benefited from that, from advances that happened in Argentina and Brazil. So we have certainly learned that it's very important to think about food for your country, but also for others and towards the outside, to access the sectors that need food in the world, and we can provide it. In terms of technical cooperation, AICA is a wonderful example of what you need to foster cooperation. Right now, those two things have to work together. And the type of crisis we are living forces us to think in our countries, in Latin America, and the world, and everything that we have to offer to the world from this region, providing food. Following along those lines of what Manuel has already mentioned, AICA has an extremely important role to play. First of all, because food is certainly going to be a central issue in the post-COVID world. Manuel has said it, I agree with him. We will have to look at food security, food consumption in different sectors. That's one point. The other thing, also mentioned by Manuel, is whether we will continue just producing commodities in the food sector. And thirdly, the rural matters are not just agriculture. And AICA has reflected very much around what it means to be in the rural world, in the rural sector. There, we will have a very important element as well. One of the large inequalities that will be highlighted after the crisis is territorial inequality. So the voice that AICA can give to this will be essential. And I think we can collaborate so much in science and innovation. I do believe that we have a great area for integration and collaboration among our countries. Let's do something. Let's do something at our institutions to ensure the collaboration in that sense. I'd like to close just congratulating AICA for this initiative. I'm sure this will be part of the new norm. We will not have a vaccine as quickly as people would like, so many things will have to continue virtually for a reasonable time. Hopefully this type of contact and the possibility of being together, although we are socially distant through COVID-19, can be maintained, and that we can coordinate our efforts and think together. think about the coming world. Thank you, Rebecca. Before going to the conclusion with Manuel, I'd like to thank you very much, the Uruguayan from the south and Uruguayan from the north, as Enrique said. Thank you for your participation. Your two countries in these uncertain times are showing interesting paths for all of us. It's important to highlight that as well. Thank you for your participation and your interesting words. Thank you to AICA, Dr. Manuel Otero, the Technical Cooperation Unit. There's a great work team there. Thank you to the Knowledge Management Sector of the Hemispheric Organization. Remember, this is our inaugural seminar, thinking about the world and food security in Latin America and the Caribbean in the post-COVID-19 world. A phenomenal initiative. Thank you so much, Manuel. And I'm sure we will have more opportunities to think about our world going forward.
Muchísimas gracias, Guido.
Thank you very much, Guido. Thank you also especially to Rebecca and Enrique, your great contributions. To remind you, Enrique, as an Argentinian, I lived 8 years in Uruguay, so I'm an expert in Chivitos, La Rambla, the markets and fairs you can find, and 10 years now in Costa Rica. So I am a bridge between those two small but large countries. I also learned that being small is a good business, but you have to be strong. You have to think, to be a forward thinker, to have friends institutionally and personally in these difficult times that will help us find more cooperation, more technical cooperation as well. Thank you really so much for your insights. And as Rebecca said, I will certainly call on you in terms of science and technology. AICA has a network of centers that was created when Enrique was president of ADB, so we will reinforce that. Thank you so much. Once again, have a great day. We continue with social isolation, but we are together even though we are distant. Thank you so much.